our conference toastmaster. Many of you know her. Distinguished toastmaster, Linda Enigan.
Thank you, Madam Sergeant at Arms. Is everyone ready for evaluation contest? Yay! Where's my cheerleader guy? Are you out there? Let's get some more excitement into this. Who's ready for an evaluation contest? Yeah! Now, I was trying to think of the most coolest way to get everyone involved, and I want you to put your phones away in a minute, but if you want to take them out real quick and take a selfie, I was dared to take a selfie up here with all of you, so I'm going to do that really quick. Oh. Awesome. I was dared by our immediate past district governor, Michelle Cable, so I'm laying blame where it belongs. Now that you've taken your selfies, do you feel involved? Okay, evaluations is what caused Toastmasters to take off. So it's because of evaluations we are here today. Let's get this party started. I have the honor of introducing to you Barbara Blackley. She's been in Toastmasters world for over 5 years and took on her fears concerning communication and wanting to improve her leadership skills. Had plenty of practice with that. Being a member of 5 clubs, serving as an officer in all 5, served as an area governor of the 2013 term, and now serving as the North Division governor, Barbara's goal is to help others learn their own voice and not to be fearful. Everyone should have a chance to be heard. She was very honored to be the 2014 contest chair for the evaluation contest because it's another challenge to conquer and to lead by example. And don't worry, there's more challenges behind this. You don't get off the hook that easily. Please help me welcome Barbara Blackley, distinguished Toastmaster.
To introduce our Toastmaster for the evaluation contest. And I have to make sure I read this correctly. He even put pauses on my stage. Here we go.
Good, he should.
As a professional speaker, coach, and award-winning Toastmaster, Matthew has engaged and entertained audience across the Midwest, having studied improv and storytelling at the Second City Theater. Matthew truly believes all the world's a stage. Matthew's professional background includes the art and science of all things digital. He spent time in Discovery Card assisting the management of multi-million dollar projects and eventually moved into advertising where he helped major brands such as Whirlpool, Maytag, Philip Morris, and Earth Hour, digital campaigns. Currently, he managed the development of websites for several local companies in Chicago's West Loop. As a passionate evaluator and past competitor, Matthew is excited to be the Toastmaster for today's contest. To finally learn what does the Fox say, please welcome Matthew Fox, ACBALB.
Especially in front of a room full of Toastmasters.
Ladies and gentlemen,
it is my esteemed honor to formally welcome you to the evaluation contest. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there's a few things that we have to get out of the way before we actually get into the contest. For example,
as we mentioned earlier,
if you have that device which you look to in the morning, look to in the evening, please make sure to silence it. I can't tell you what an annoyance it is as a contestant myself in the past to have that buzz beep, something going off to distract us from the awesomeness that you're going to see this morning. Now, District 30, all of us wouldn't be here without an important crew leading us. And I'd like to recognize a few of those people. So when I call your name, if you could please stand and be recognized as a dignitary of District 30. So we'll start at the top. District Governor Donna Weston. Lieutenant Governor in Training Ethel Goatee. Lieutenant Governor of Marketing Melissa Newport. Secretary, and the one who sends out amazing emails, Linda Ritz. Our Sergeant at Arms for the District, Elizabeth Stevenson. Our Parliamentarian, Bob Roman. Our immediate past governor, Michelle Cable. Our administrative chair, Don Williams. And our recognition chair, who doesn't like to be recognized, Sharon Cruz. I'll now move into our division governors. These are the people that, as area governors, we constantly rely on for success. With the Northwest Division, Tiffany Salinko. Central South Division, Rachel Mohammed. Southwest Division, Chris Pistakis. And you saw her a little bit earlier, but let's take a second to recognize her again, our esteemed North Division Governor, Barbara Beckley. Our South Division Governor, Cassandra Lee. And our West Division Governor, Frank Hester. And there's a few other past officers here. If you could please stand and be recognized. I believe we have Carolyn Arthur in the room, who's a past district governor. Mike Rafferty, I believe, is here. Micheline Swart?
Micheline
Swart. Thank you. And last but not least, Dick Storer. All right, and one final thing to recognize, just because they are the day-to-day people, they are the reason the clubs are as successful as they are, because they're our constant contact to the district. If all area governors could please stand up and be recognized. All right, so we have some of the formal things taken care of. Now in my best announcer voice possible, ladies and gentlemen, contestants, timers, ballot counters, and sergeant-at-arms have all been briefed prior to the beginning of the contest. Everyone is aware of the Toastmaster International rules that govern this contest. No one should enter or leave the premises during the minute of silence, during the contestants' presentations. You may do so if time permits during the minute of silence between presentations. Ladies and gentlemen, with that said, let the contest begin! I will now give the order of our contestants. So judges, those of you who like to follow along on your ballots, please mark down the number and the name of the individual speaking. First, we have Rebecca Gonkey. Speaker number one is Rebecca Gonkey. Speaker number two is Dorsey Smith. Speaker number two is Dorsey Smith. Speaker number three is Carolyn Null Anderson. Speaker number three is Carolyn Null Anderson. Speaker number four, Garrett Gray. Speaker number four, Garrett Gray. Speaker number five, Barry Mixon. Speaker number five, Barry Mixon. Speaker number six, Kyle Knapp. Speaker number six, Kyle Knapp. Speaker number seven, Jeffrey Stein. Speaker number seven, Jeffrey Stein. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, for those of you playing along at home, we do have an eighth contestant. Speaker number eight, Iqbal Acha. Speaker number eight, Iqbal Acha. Does anyone need those again? All right, fantastic. Now, I'm assuming most people in the room, you've been to a contest before. Well, I would love to stand up here and speak for the next 5 to 7 minutes, but you heard enough of me. I think it's time to get our target speaker up on stage. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Sean Green, Adversity. Adversity, Sean Green.
Adversity. Good? Adversity. So, by definition, adversity is a difficult situation or condition. How many people have had a kid go through a grocery store, Target, somewhere, and not act like they should? Creates a little bit of adversity, right? How many athletes we have in the crowd where you play high school basketball, teams pressing you, coach calls timeout, adversity. How many people have dealt with cancer in their lives? Great. So have I. 5 years ago, I was diagnosed with stage 3 brain cancer. So what I will do, I will take you a little bit through my personal and professional experience of dealing with stage 3 brain cancer. Personally, I'm an identical twin. My identical twin is here, Shane. We grew up in a small town in southeast Missouri, blinking yellow light. I'm married to a girl from our hometown. We've been together for about 21 years. We live in Roscoe Village. 5 years ago, almost 6 years ago now, I was employed at Tribune Company. We started traveling a lot, and many of you know about the media industry. We were going in bankruptcy, and at Tribune Company, all the publishing sites had their own technology departments. So we went private. The new CTO decided, hey, we're going to consolidate all the technology departments into one. I was fortunate enough to be promoted to director of technology at the Tribune Company. So I was traveling a lot. Spend a lot of time on the road. I like to work out a lot. During that travel time, I wasn't able to work out a lot. I started getting some migraines, and then in the past, my personal life, we played college basketball together, never got hit in the head, never did anything. Played some recreation basketball with some friends that we went to college with, and faked the guy out and jumped on top of me. I think I got a concussion, never went to the hospital. But my sister-in-law said I had a concussion because I got sick and stuff like that. So then I started getting migraines. During that time, I started traveling a lot. I started getting migraines too. And as I'd get migraines, you know, I'd gotten since we were playing basketball, so I knew what I had to do. I needed to go home and go sleep it off, do some things like that. But as I was traveling so much, I wasn't working out as much. I mean, we love to work out, and I say we, I'm always going to refer to Shane and me. I wasn't working out enough. So during the time that I was traveling and deciding what we were going to do with technology consolidations, I was getting more migraines, or what I thought was migraines. During that time, I was insourcing our service desk back from India to Orlando. Orlando Sentinel had some spots, a big spot open. It was cheaper from a financial perspective where to put our service desk. So I had worked out at this 24/7 fitness and on a Saturday morning. And this is in January of 2009, and I'm walking back home, and my wife and I always go to this place called Braska. If anybody lives in Roscoe Village or downtown area, it's a pizzeria wine bar. Go there quite often, love the place. So we're walking there, and as we're walking there, I started getting numbness in my right side, my leg. All right, you know, hey, I'm good. We'll go ahead and go there and eat. A little bit of adversity, right? So we're there. And next thing you know, it's kind of moving up the right side of my body. And I'm like, all right, a little thirsty here. Go ahead and eat, I'm hungry. Just worked out, right? So we're eating, and then we're sitting, I was sitting at the bar, talk to the bartenders, talk to everybody. I know everybody that works there, it's awesome. So we're sitting there, and next thing you know, the right side of my face got numb. And talking to my wife, she goes, "You sure you're okay?" And I go, "Yeah, I think I'm okay." So I eat my pizza, drink my iced tea that I love, go home. I said, "You know what?" She goes, "Are you sure you're okay?" I said, "Yeah, I just need to sleep." So I went home and slept for probably 2 or 3 hours. And then after that, we went out and met some friends to watch some NFL playoffs, right? Still with some little bit of adversity, I could watch a little bit of football, have a beer maybe or two. So the next morning, I flew to Orlando. So I flew to Orlando Sunday morning. So when I get down there, I tell the manager that's reporting to me that's actually managing the service desk that we insourced. I said, "Hey man, this weird thing happened to me. I got numb on the entire right side of my body. I told my wife, I'll go to the doctor, I promise I'll go to the doctor." So that Monday, I scheduled an appointment with the doctor for the following Thursday, because I was down there all week. Hey, I'm all right. As I'm down there, I struggle. I really struggle throughout Monday, the Tuesday, and I'm like, man, something's not right. So then I'm like, I'm not working out enough. I need to work out more. But during the week, the hotel I was staying at was right across the street from the Orlando Sentinel, so I wasn't feeling good. I'd go there like 2 o'clock and then kind of work from the program that I was there. So I was like, you know what? So I went home Friday. The insourcing had started to work. It was great. I go home. Things were going like they should. So I get home and I work out Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. The Tribune Company has a fitness center in the basement, so I used to get up early in the morning, go work out first, and go to work. So I was too tired to work out Monday. Cool, no problem, get to work, fine. Monday night going into Tuesday, I had what I thought was a migraine. So during that time, my wife said, "Look, you can't sit still in bed. I'm going to the couch." Tuesday night, a little bit of adversity, she goes to the couch. All right, she comes in the room about 3:15 Wednesday morning, and I'm sitting on the side of the bed with what I thought was another migraine. She goes back, lays down, she comes back, she says, "You sure you're okay?" I said, "You know what, take me to Northwestern. I think I'm having a migraine. They'll give me some spray, I'll be able to go home." We go to Northwestern, January 14th, 2009. I go in, I start talking to them, tell them what to do. My wife calls Shane and my sister-in-law, who's 5 months pregnant with their second child. They come down. Our older brother lives up here with us. They're at the hospital. So about 6:30, Shane, Carrie, and our older brother Kevin were at the hospital. I come back out from the CAT scans and stuff after telling my story. The ER director closes the curtain and says, "There's a mass that's got to come out." Shane's crying, my wife's crying, my sister-in-law's crying. I'm like, okay, what's next? I can't cry, I mean, hey, I have a little bit of adversity, but I'll be okay. So they admitted me to the neurological intensive care. I spent 2 days there. They had numbed the pain, and I had surgery, radiation, and 18 months of chemo. During that time, I learned a tremendous amount about what people mean to you. Without my twin brother, without my wife, without the people that surrounded me, it was amazing. Since then, I've ran 10 half marathons, and then at the end of 2010, 5 months after my last round of chemo, I ran the Las Vegas Marathon with my wife's friends and family. We can all deal with adversity. I think if you surround yourself with amazing people throughout your life, you can deal with it. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll now give our speech contestants 5 minutes to complete their evaluations. Sergeant at Arms, if you could please escort our contestants out of the room starting now and time them when they sit down in the room for 5 minutes. When that 5 minutes is over, please escort our first contestant back to the room. Now, while the evaluations are being completed, I don't think we heard enough from our target speaker. That was a pretty amazing experience. I felt the adversity, and I'd like to get him back up here to learn a little bit more. So please help me welcome Sean Green back to the stage. We're gonna do a quick mic check. So while we're doing that, we can all take a deep breath. Alright, good? Alright, Sean, there's so much I want to ask you, but I want to get some of the basics out of the way first. Club name, how long you've been in Toastmasters?
Microsoft Midwest Vegas Toastmasters, 4 months.
And what's your, I'm assuming I know what your education level is, but...
Yeah, I have an MBA in project management.
Okay. Your Toastmasters education. That's right. We'll have a quick education session later. There's a CC, a CL. All right. Well, you have
new. I'm very new to Toastmasters.
You have such an amazing story. I picture you as the type of kid where you'd like fall off your bike and you might skin your knee, but you'd rub a little dirt.
Yeah, of course. Get back on.
As a fellow athlete, and a collegiate athlete as well, what did athletics teach you about adversity?
Mental toughness. I think that's probably the biggest thing. Surround yourself with good people. I think that's the main thing. I think, and don't quit. I think that for Shane and I, two 6 foot guys trying to play college basketball, you have to outwork people. You have to be determined. You have to be somewhat, I think it's more about working people and just being smarter. Trying to outsmart people sometimes, give them a little push, I think athletics is something that, in competition, I think it's competitive. It's allowed me to transition into sales. From being a director of IT at Tribune to moving over to a sales organization a year and a half ago, too.
Now, there's many people in Toastmasters who they'd be afraid to get up and do a target speech. This is a lot of pressure. We're in front of an entire district. Can you give us some advice to help some of those people out there who maybe are thinking, oh, I could never be up here?
Well, let me say this. Rachel Muhammad, Dee Marie, stand up. They're amazing. They are.
But I did this as my icebreaker for not as much. I added a little bit more to it. But they are amazing. They are awesome at what they do. So they really inspired me to get up here and do this contest.
Wow. So this is your first?
This is my yes. This is my first contest.
Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, first.
I'm Shane and I are really engaged in Brushes with Cancer. We run the Northwestern Brain Tumor Half every year. We love being involved in helping people who have cancer and they're dealing with it. I have a lot of friends that, it's amazing once you're diagnosed with cancer, how many people you know that are either caregivers or they've experienced themselves with the brain or some other kind of cancer. So it's pretty cool. We're blessed. I'm lucky to be alive, one, and to have my best friend, my twin brother, by my side all the time. My wife, our 20-month-old daughter that we were blessed to have born. So I'm very fortunate.
Wow. Timer, how are we doing?
About another minute.
All right. So I'll go a little bit deeper here. You hit on some tones about the meaning of life in your speech. And if we don't have a lot of time, but if you could do like a 30 second, what's the meaning of life?
So I would say this, when I was diagnosed with brain cancer, people would say, how are you doing? I'd say, every day's a good day. It really is. Shane and I have every day's a good day with a brain cancer gray tattooed on our sides. His is a little bit bigger than mine because it meant a lot to him. And it meant a lot to me too, but that's what I said. How are you doing? I'm great. I'm alive. You deal with a lot of adversity at work. You know, I just had a possible $500,000 SOW maybe not get signed yesterday. So, hey, I can deal with it. It happens. We're working on getting signed, though. But, I enjoy life. There's a lot of other people in worse shape than I am. I'm still alive, kicking, lucky every day. Enjoy it. We all have issues that we deal with. Basis. You know, I'm heavily involved in IC Stars, and I tell these kids, some of them kids, some of them a little bit older, but enjoy it. You have to be motivated to succeed. And you know, that's really the way I live my life now, for sure. And I thought I had a pretty good outlook on life before, but yeah, sure. You get the surgery, and I have a scar that runs down my head. I had radiation, my hair fell out.
It looks good now.
You know, like, hey, it looks good. This is my November beard that Shane didn't grow. I talk and let our naturally curly hair grow out, so. But every day is a good day.
All right, so one small last question, and this will be a little bit shorter response. Adversity and Toastmasters. What's like one or two words that you can give us to help overcome that?
I think it's just being committed. I think that with our Toastmasters, it's a matter of getting people to commit to get better. I joined Toastmasters to improve. I speak a lot in front of people all the time, but really to speak in front of everybody here today that I have no idea who they are besides Ingrid and Rachel and Oscar, if he's here. I haven't seen Oscar yet. I thought he was going to be here. So this is Oscar. I've met Ethel through email.
I think everyone's met Ethel.
Yeah.
We love you, Ethel. All right, on behalf, behalf of District 30, and as the humble Toastmaster, I'd like to present you with this gift as a thank you for not only doing a speech up here, but doing your first speech. And I'll give you a hug after that. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe we should have our first contestant outside the room any second now. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we get to the interesting part. We are ready to hear from our evaluation contestants. Just as a reminder, there will be 1 minute of silence before the first contestant and between each contestant. Now, my Jeopardy song, Rope, so please stay quiet during that minute of silence. Timekeepers, when I advise you to do so, please signal me with a green light when 1 minute is up. After all the contestants have spoken, the judges should complete your ballots, and the ballot counters will come by to collect them. So we will now begin the speech evaluation contest. If we could please have 1 minute of silence. Speech contestant number one, Rebecca Gonkey. Rebecca Gonkey, evaluation contestant number one.
Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster, all of my fellow Toastmasters and our guests, but especially thank you to Sean for your speech. I'm going to start out really a general on this. I have to acknowledge the bravery that it took to come up here. I feel like you had some adversity just stepping up onto this stage in a room full of this many people and talking about a very personal and emotional topic, and I want to commend you for that. It's always difficult to be the target speaker. You are talking to a group that you're not familiar with, and you know that you're going to get feedback from 8 different people. So congratulations on that. I also wanted to call out some of the strengths of your speech, and I'll tell you that one of them I didn't think was going to be a strength. It was your title. When I heard the Toastmaster announce Sean Green, adversity, I was like, oh man, all those motivational speakers, they talk about adversity. But your speech was wonderful. It wasn't at all generic. It wasn't focused on all of the things that you should do in a very generic way to overcome adversity. You tackled your own personal struggle and how you dealt with it. And you did a fantastic job of acknowledging your family and all of the support that they gave you. I also thought that your speech was very appropriate because even though it was about your personal journey, you made it relatable. And one of the first things you did was you drew in the audience by talking about some of the more typical adversities that we might face just in life as we know it. Now, I have to tell you that you made my part right here a lot easier because while I thought I had adversity when I started this, I have nothing like what you've gone through, and that's sort of reassuring for an evaluator. If I were to give you the gift, something that might help you deliver this speech more effectively in the future, I think I would focus on two things. First of all, this is an emotional topic, and whenever we're talking about something personal, it's easy to use a lot of filler words, and you did some of that. There were quite a few ums in your speech. The other thing is time management. The ending of your speech felt a little bit abrupt. You gave us a lot of detail about your workout schedule and your diagnosis up front, and then we started to see the cards go up, and the ending felt a little abrupt. One of the things I would most like to know is, I hope that you are actually no evidence of disease now, but I think, you know, we could have had a little smoother ending. But overall, those were minor defects in a very effective and moving speech, and I want to thank you for that. Thank you.
If we could please have 1 minute on the clock. And ladies and gentlemen, please remain silent for the next minute while the judges mark their ballots. Dorsey Smith, evaluation contestant number two. Evaluation contestant number two, Dorsey Smith. Thank you. Carolyn Null Anderson, evaluation contestant number three. Evaluation contestant number three, Carolyn Null Anderson.
Fellow Toastmasters and honored guests, especially Sean. Sean, you are a cancer survivor. I want to hear this room rock for cancer survivors. Everybody rock! Everybody in this room knows a cancer survivor. Someone in this room is probably a cancer survivor. I know cancer. My dad had cancer. My mother survived cancer. My best friend has a brain tumor, and she is going through it, but she will survive. It's now Cancer Survive. This is a relatable story. Cancer survives. We came in with an opening, right away adversity, and thinking this is going to be a heavy speech. It was a heavy speech, and it was cancer. And we all related, and we had an opening question. We all came in, and I was shaking because cancer scares me. It scares me. Brain tumors scare me. But we came in, and then all of a sudden, we're taken into this heavy, very emotional, serious story. But Sean, what did you do? You brought humor to us. I love the humor. I stopped shaking. I stopped remembering the fears of cancer. And was so in, I love the peppering of humor. The shaking of the leg, the numbness. Oh, I'm fine with the migraine. You know, I'm at work better. I'll just go to the gym. I'll work it off. It'll be fine. No problem. Oh, honey, I'm fine. Just a brain tumor. Okay, great. Yeah, okay, we're going to operate. Great. Let's get on with it. No problem. It just lightened a very serious story, and we all need to hear that with cancer. We all need to hear that with cancer. And the other thing I liked with your story was it was very organized and visual. I came in right in the beginning. The opening came in. Then you took us on your journey, your life before cancer. Figuring out you had cancer, getting there, and surviving. Sean, you rocked on with another half marathon. Lovely transitional organizational story. And the visualizations were so clear to me. On the bed, in the emergency room, at the wine bar. Everything was so clear to me. And in the end, surviving. Surviving and running on. What could you do better? I would have loved this story more with a couple pauses. You have brain cancer. Pause, we can all think about it. I have cancer. Pause. I have amazing friends. They got me through. I pause. I think too, and up and down in your voice would have been better. Or even your wife's reactions. Tears, more up and down. A vocal variety, a little softer, a little louder. And also watch a little bit of your ums and your so's. A little bit of that. But more use of the stage, maybe more expression. But what I liked in conclusion is this was a heavy, serious speech, but we ended with inspiration because you are a survivor. With friends, amazing. Congratulations, Sean. Thank you.
One minute of silence while the judges mark the ballots. Timer, if you could please put 1 minute on the clock. 3, evaluation contestant number 4. Evaluation contestant number 4, Garrett Gray.
Chair, fellow Toastmasters, guests, and especially Sean. I hope I'm talking to Sean and not your twin. I don't want to give the wrong evaluation to the wrong person. Great speech about overcoming adversity, my friend. Inspiration. Today I'm going to talk about 3 things I liked about your speech because they displayed mastery. I'm also going to talk about 3 potential areas of growth going forward. And last, my friend, I'm going to tell you thing I absolutely loved about your speech here today. Number 1, I really like your storytelling. You told a story up here on stage. Not only that, it was your story. You lived it, you experienced it, you survived. Instant credibility. Well done. Number 2, you had great eye contact throughout your whole speech. It showed you were prepared, no notes, no lectern, but mostly you had that connection with us. Very powerful. Number 3, humor. You talked about this heavy topic, brain cancer. Possible death. But you peppered in humor to alleviate that tension. And that's necessary on heavy topics. Very effective use of humor. Now, 3 potential growth areas going forward are as follows. Number 1, you began with, how many have had a kid act up at a store? How many have played sports? I suggest using a you-focused question. Have you played sports? Have you had a kid act up? Address the masses, but speak to the individual. You. Just that one word. That connection will increase even more. Number 2, staging. I felt you moved without purpose on stage. I felt it would be more effective if you began here and progressed chronologically as you found that you went from fit to having health problems, to seeing a doctor, to running in a marathon. Break it up visually for us in the audience. Number 3, gestures. Your gestures were mostly in a neutral position. And I felt there was opportunities when you talk about basketball, hitting that jump shot where your leg went numb. Just bring that story into a deeper level. Flesh it out, make it more vivid, more powerful. Now, Sean, the thing I mostly liked about your speech, in fact, I loved it, was your message of overcoming adversity. You're a walking and running and talking example. That's very powerful. Many of us have had family members, friends who have had cancer and maybe not have been as lucky to survive. But Jeff, if you stick to your overall strengths, great storytelling, that awesome magnetic eye contact, that humor, just kick up a notch, your staging, you focused intro, and your gestures. The next time you speak, you'll overcome any speaking obstacle, my friend. Not just you.
One minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots. If we could please have 1 minute. Barry Mixon, evaluation contestant number 5. Evaluation contestant number 5, Barry Nixon.
Madam Toastmaster, Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and distinguished guests. Sean, when I start an evaluation of a speech, the first thing that I'm looking for actually happened long before you came on the stage. Because at some point in time, you had to make the decision between giving a speech and telling a story. Sean, today you spoke for 7 minutes and 47 seconds, and I love what you did with your time. Because today, you told us a story. And I know it was a story because it did all the three things that a good story does. You started out your story with the title, Adversity. All of us have heard stories about adversity, so normally you're sitting there saying, okay, here it comes. But you didn't do that. You came up on the stage, actually kind of like a sportsman as you are, and said, Adversity. I started thinking about the way Cubs fans probably feel. This is the new adversity. You started describing all the different things in your family, where you work. And at some point I started saying, okay, where's the adversity part? And then you brought us to the restaurant that you were eating at. You told us about your twin brother. Those are the things that are memorable about your story. Next, you began to lead us down to that fateful day where your wife kept telling you, go get checked out. And all the gentlemen, all the people here who know that they should go to the doctor started thinking, you know, maybe you got a point there. I started seeing the audience feeling themselves, start saying, yeah, I got something wrong. Those are the things that a good story does because you called us to action. You made us start thinking, what do I need to check out in my own body? I love the way you dated your story. January 2009, you started using the word adversity throughout your journey, reminding us that ultimately, I'm going to tell you something in this wonderful story that spoke to your adversity. And then you said the words that none of us ever want to hear. There's a mask that we have to take out. That really called us to action. That made us remember what you said. And most importantly, it made us leave this audience thinking, what am I going to do? All of us will leave here today, and the best part of the story is when you need to want to tell your friends. So when you put those three things together, when you make a story memorable, when you make a story call you to action, and most importantly, when you make a story, tell your friends, that is a story, and you will know it's a story, even though this may be early in your Toastmaster career, because when you put all three things together, it creates a sound that no one has ever heard. It's a cliche to say, I will wait for your next story, but I don't have to wait, because I will feel your story. As soon as I go to the doctor, I will remember your story. Mr. Toastmaster.
Kyle Knapp, a
Evaluation contestant number six. Evaluation contestant number six, Kaya Knapp.
Thank you, Mr. Contest Chair, dignitaries, fellow Toastmasters, most welcome guests, and especially Sean. Thank you for that speech today. That was wonderful. You started out very confident. You have a topic that was relevant. Everybody can relate to adversity. And I think what was really powerful is you led us down a path of giving us some examples of some things that we can relate to. How many people have had a sports injury? How many people have had a setback in a relationship? I had cancer. And you just let the air out of the room. And from that point, I think that was really powerful, because then, if I wasn't paying attention before, I sure am now. That was very good. There were many positive things in addition to that. You had the strong intro and the pause that let us get into the speech. You had very good pacing. I thought that it was very comfortable. We weren't rushed. We could follow along. We could really take in what you were saying, and I think that was really important for your story. You used gestures very well. I thought there were a lot of times that when you were communicating with people that we could follow you and see that there was a conversation, so that was very helpful. And humor. You did a very good job introducing humor. And I like the way that you did it, because you talked about with your wife asking, "Are you okay, honey?" "Yeah, I'm good. I got this under control." And then what's going on in the back of your mind is, "Something's not right here." And that was very helpful, because I'm sure that's what was going through your mind. And we all want to ignore those things in our body and things that are happening. We want to just push them aside, so I thought that was very helpful. Some things that I think you can improve. Every speech always has something that you can improve on. You had a few ahs and ahs. Those are some things that we always try to minimize in Toastmasters. We always have the ah counter, keeping track. Just a couple of them that you could cut down on that. I think maybe your movement could be a little more deliberate. I felt a lot of times that you were kind of moving around and talking, and there wasn't really a purpose for that. And I think maybe just be a little more deliberate with your movement. Your vocal variety, I think, could be a little variated to emphasize things. When your wife, you could be talking to your wife, and you could say that, "My wife said, honey, are you okay?" And then you can kind of go, "Yeah, I'm good, I got it, under control." So I think that could kind of help just emphasize the points. Your closing was a little bit too abrupt. I felt that we got to the end, and because it was such a wonderful story, we all want to listen and keep going, this is great. And then you get to the point, and then it's important to have friends and family with you. Thank you. If you want that, I wanted some more. So I think that could be just to kind of wrap it up a little bit. But in general, it was a great speech. Thank you for telling that heartfelt story. Keep your confidence up. Keep your pacing. Use good stories like that. Make a little fine-tune adjustments. And I think you've got a really good inspirational speech that's relevant to any audience. Again, thank you very much. Mr. Contest.
Once again, 1 minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots. Jeff Stein, evaluation contestant number 7. Evaluation contestant number 7, Jeff Stein.
I can't feel half my face, but I'm okay. I seem to be limping a little bit, but I'm fine. Talk about adversity. My fellow Toastmasters, Mr. Contest Chair, and Sean, your speech was about a journey. The journey of your adversity. And it was an incredible one, and one we all need to hear. So I want to talk to you today about what you mastered and what you need to do to grow to make that speech better, because more people need to hear about that. It's important that people get their journeys out there. The first thing I want to do is congratulate you for getting up here. There's, what, 300-400 people in this room? That is incredible. That is not easy. What I really loved was how you opened. You used a question, but then you really hit us with it. You sat there and said, oh, by the way, I have stage 3 brain cancer. Wow. Really? I mean, it's like you took a hammer and bam, over the head with it. And that got everybody in this room awake. I saw people go, whoa, what was that? I mean, really, that was impressive. You have great storytelling ability. You really were able to weave what you were talking about and give us some great insight as to what that journey took and where you went. Now, what I really enjoyed was how you used humor. Some examples I just gave you about, well, my face was half numb, but I'm fine, everything's okay. Or that your leg was not working, but you're fine. Or I'm gonna go work out, but I'll be fine. I won't need 911, I'll be fine. So those were the areas I felt you really excelled. You were really able to engage the audience. We heard quite a bit of laughs, not many groans, and you really got this audience behind you. And why wouldn't they be? You had an amazing story and a great one to tell. So let's talk about what you can do to make that story better. Now, I'm going to guess there are quite a few people in here who already talked to you about some of your movements and your hand movements. A lot of that is because you were nervous. And I know you were nervous, because I saw every time you paused, you kind of did one of these. Or you start to move. Relax. Take it easy. Everybody is here for you. They want to hear your story. They want to hear what you have to say. If you just relax and take that 2 seconds and then speak, that will get better. I loved your story, but at a certain point, I wasn't exactly sure where you were going with it. There was adversity, and then you continued to tell us the journey, but you never told us what adversities you were going to overcome, which brings us to really the big key. You buried the lead. You told us about how friends were important, how you did 10 and a half marathons, how you did one after chemo. Those are all things we wanted to hear about. That's impressive. That's incredible. That's me wondering exactly what the heck I'm doing with my life. Your journey is incredible. You told us amazing things. You made us laugh. You really made us enjoy this. You just got to work on relaxing and getting that story straight. Mr. Contest Chair.
Iqbal Acha, evaluation contestant number 8. Evaluation contestant number 8, Iqbal Acha.
Mr. Contest Toastmaster. Fellow Toastmasters, guests, and most importantly, Sean. Sean, I have to be honest with you. Your speech was both informative and inspirational. I was very impressed with your ability to connect with the audience, not just well, but quickly. You had a lot of great details that you added throughout your speech, and there's several things I want to share with you today that will help reinforce the strengths that you've demonstrated here this morning. Number one, your attention to detail and your organizational skills was impeccable. You were able to establish that rapport with us, not simply just by asking us a series of questions that helped us connect with what your topic was going to be, but you also were able to keep us riveted at the edge of our seats every single step of the way. Again, the chronology of your speech was great because when you begin, you simply asked us to have that connection with you by wondering what sort of, you know, when we looked at kids in the store and if we were in a sports team and our coach pulled us apart, how would you feel in terms of adversity? And then you dropped a bomb on us. You know what it's like to have cancer because you've lived it. And the details that you added to that helped each and every single one of us understand the journey that you took. But John, you are a superb storyteller. And I underline the word superb because of the amount of details that you added and the fact that as a storyteller, you took us on the journey again with you. You talked about your life as working as a sales and marketing individual for the Tribune. You talked about how your busy schedule prevented you from working out. You also talked about the challenges that you faced while you were working out in terms of the numbness that started to creep up. And we fell for it, hook, line, and sinker, in a great way. I feel for your wife who has to sit there on the opposite side of the table and going, sweetie, you know you're not okay. And you're like, no, no, I'm fine. Really, I'm fine. On behalf of every man here, I thank you for that. Woman, I completely empathize because I know my wife is like, shut up, you're not fine. But you do that so well. And that is the genuine part about you, Sean, that really brought it out here. The last thing I want to share with you, you culminated because when I said it was informative and inspirational, you inspired us by letting us know it's not over. You don't end when you just have this journey. You talked about the things that you went through. The power of three that you suggested, which was surgery, chemotherapy, and then therapy after that, the support from your family. Each and every one of these things motivates us to realize that no matter what the adversity is, there's hope and there's a way out. Sean, how can you improve this speech just so that you are able to become a better performer? I only have two recommendations for you. Number one, I felt that throughout most of this speech, you kept your hands and your fingers right at your chest. And while that can be a comfortable pose in the beginning, it should stop at some point so that you become acclimated to the stage, acclimated to your audience, and acclimated to your aura. And number two, Sean, what I would have loved to have seen are some of the personal insights of your own journey. I know as a guy, we're like, hey, don't worry about it. I'm okay. It's right. But it would have been great if you had just shared a little bit more emotion, like, I was scared. It was concerning. But I'm okay now. So Sean, continue to do what you do so well, chronology, the superb storytelling, and then work on just those two things about keeping your hands to your side, and then I cannot wait to see the opportunity for you to grace the stage again. Mr. Contest.
Ladies and gentlemen, if we could please remain silent while the judges complete their ballots and the ballot counters collect the ballots. Thank you. Thank you, Chief Judge. All right, ladies and gentlemen, my second favorite part, just after the target speaker and the evaluations, is to get to know our evaluators. So evaluators, if you could please join me on my right in the order that you spoke. Give them a big round of applause, brothers. Tell me how long you've been in Toastmasters, your club, and your current educational work.
8 years. ANU at Leadership Toastmasters, known as ALTO 897901.
Yes.
Awesome. So we're moving pretty fast here. You got 30 seconds or less. Can you tell me a little bit about your favorite quote? Babies are not dying?
Babies are not dying is the way that I prioritize work. I'm in a workplace club, and we have a lot of catastrophes in our workplace of varying complexity. So babies are not dying is the way that I tell people. It's important, but we could probably take a deep breath and deal with this in 2 minutes.
Fantastic. Well, on behalf of District 30, I'd like to present you with a certificate of participation. Thank you for being a contestant today. All right, Dorsey, you're up.
Dorsey Smith, Articulators of the Windy City, 01075075 68.
Awesome.
2 years.
Right, I love your style up here, and I wonder, do you have some theater or singing background?
Yes, I do.
Can you belt a quick tune for us?
Sure.
30 seconds or less.
In a sentimental moon, I see the stars come through my room, and your loving attitude is like a flame that lights the gloom.
The District 30, thank you so much for participating today.
My name is Carolyn Null Anderson, and I'm in Club 9692, which is the Red Hot Toastmasters Club. And the big red building downtown, the CNA building.
Again, I noticed you had a bit of a theatrical style. Can you tell us how that's helped you with Toastmasters?
Well, I would say it was a big help in the prior contest to get here because the woman gave a speech about being pregnant and I was up against 6 other men. That was fairly easy, seeing I had been through 2 pregnancies.
You kind of had the end.
So, and as today, I know quite a few cancer survivors. It's very inspiring. Excellent. Thank you very much.
Right. I love the energy. I wish I could keep you up here all day, but Carolyn, on behalf of District 30, thank you for participating. All right, Garrett, you did this, I think, last weekend or 2 weeks ago. You know the drill.
I'm Garrett Gray. I've been a Toastmaster for 2 years. I'm representing Windy City Professional Speakers Toastmasters today. That's called 5283.
Now, I don't believe everyone in the audience knows what you were up to. I think you were spinning a few tails in a different district. Were you cheating on District 30?
Yeah, I was two-timing District 30. I was in the Tall Tales contest last Friday, so it was fun.
Don't leave us hanging. How did it go?
I finished third.
Garrett, as I told the other contestants, as we had all day, I'd love to hear the story, but thank you for participating.
Aaron Mixon, I'm representing Christ Universal Temple Club number 3, number 666595. I've been a Toastmaster for 5 years, 11 months, and 15 days.
Can you tell us a little bit about you?
Although you've been in Toastmasters for 5 years, you disappeared for a little while.
Were you off at Chicago Public Schools also cheating on us?
No, actually, I have the pleasure and honor of being a teacher, a science teacher in the Chicago Public School System. And those of you who are thinking about becoming a Toastmaster, I am a pretty good teacher because of my training as a Toastmaster. Because as difficult as this is, it's nothing in comparison to training 150 kids every single day. And keeping their attention. At least you guys are going to sit down. It's like, sit down, stop talking, move it. I don't have to do that here. So this is like a vacation for me.
Well, as much as I'd like to continue to hear your sound of music,
so thank you very much on behalf of District 30.
Good morning again. My name is Kyle Knapp. I'm representing Naperville Toastmasters. I've been in Toastmasters about 3 years, a little more than 3 years. I have the CC and CL. I'm working on the ACB.
Wow,
that's getting put on the spot. So I use my experience in speed dating to go through the humorous speech contest, and I made it to the first and second, and just real short, I won't bore everybody with the whole story, but you meet a lot of interesting people in 6 minutes. And what I found was at the end of the whole thing, I went to speed dating a couple times, and everybody says, well, it didn't really work out for you. And I said, well, yeah, I'm still single, but I got a lot of great material for Toastmasters.
Well, Kyle, we'd love to hear more of the material, but again, in light of brevity, thank you for participating on behalf of District 30.
I'm Jeff Stein, and I am representing Unity Toastmasters today, and I've been in Toastmasters 6 years, and I just got my Distinguished Toastmaster.
I'd love to talk more about your Darren LaCroix moment just now. However, could you tell us a little bit about your DTM and what that means to you on achieving that? Because I remember when I first came into Toastmasters.
Matthew was there the first night I ever showed up at Toastmasters. He was actually prepping for a contest, so he was the first person I ever met. So it's really kind of funny to be here on stage with him, and I will make something amusing. I got a note from Darren LaCroix yesterday to say good luck. I will note to him that I had one of his moments just now. And I'll send him the video, so.
Well, Jeff, I'd love to hear all the stories from the past years and what led up to being a DTM, but thank you for participating.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Iqbal Acha. I'm representing Toastmasters Plus, Club 5677, also my home club, Masters of Opportunity, 3634. I've been with Toastmasters now for 10 years and 3 months, and on September 9th, I earned my first DTM.
Congratulations. Matt, Iqbal, it sounds like we're going to be celebrating a lot of ETMs later.
Yes.
But I've seen you outside of Toastmasters, and I wouldn't say you're cheating. It's more like you're enhancing what you're doing with your speaking. The NSA, other groups, can you tell us what that experience has been like, again, in 30 seconds or less?
I could, but I'd have to kill you. Just kidding. That's my wife's line. She used to work for the federal government. She said I could use it. Just teasing. So I do a lot of speaking internationally, and I'm also working as a health and wellness recruiter for Walmart stores, Health and Wellness. So I have a lot of opportunities to meet professionals, executives, and entrepreneurs, and just the opportunity to be there with them allows me to gain some insights in terms of what we see happening in the world today and what solutions Toastmasters can bring to them, either through myself or through the organization.
You did it. Good job.
Okay, without further ado, third place, get a round of applause here. It's Kyle Knapp.
All right.
You go to the top there, let's start coming. And in second place, what a drum roll, Garrett Craig. We will make sure he gets the trophy when we find them and him. And finally, our first place champion for the evaluation contest is Iqbal Acha. Okay. All right, so thank you everyone.